Hello and welcome to the Jazz Jam Podcast. I'm your host, Dwayne Gunnels, joined by my co-host, Max Levy. And on today's episode, we are doing an iconic Blue Note recording by the likes of Wayne Shorter. This album is Speak No Evil. It was recorded in 1964 and released on Blue Note Records, as we said. It was recorded kind of right when Wayne Shorter joined Miles Davis's quintet. And so this is Wayne's sixth album, released in 1966, but recorded in 1964. It's really known for having elements of both hard bop and modal jazz, and it's well regarded as Wayne's best records. So Max, I'm excited to get into this one. What are you thinking about this episode here today?
Well, I wanted to make sure we did a Wayne Shorter album relatively recently. You know, before the year was over, because we just lost Wayne Shorter. He passed away, I think, a couple months ago, maybe even a little further than that. But he was an incredible player and composer, really, and just an iconic figure in this music. So I really want to make sure we did some Wayne Shorter sometime soon. And so we're getting into one of his best albums, in my opinion. And if you don't know, this album, Speak No Evil, was included in Ben Ratliff's publication called Jazz, A Critic's Guide to the 100 Most Important Recordings. So according to those in the know, this is probably one of the top 100 jazz recordings, at least, that we have from the 20th century. And I think it really showcases Wayne Shorter's creativity, his compositional ability. I think he's a fantastic composer. And his overall leadership as a leader, like you said, he was really a sideman of Miles Davis's around this time. And before that, he was a sideman for Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers. So he had a lot of experience up to this point, and his leadership really shines through because of how well they play on this record and how well the compositions come across. And, you know, when you think about Wayne Shorter, and we'll get into his bio in just a second, he was really Miles's right-hand man in the time he was with Miles when talking about original recordings and compositions. And I mentioned this before once, but, you know, Wayne Shorter would write ideas in a little black book. And when it came time to record with Miles, Wayne brought that book, and a lot of the compositions that they played on some of those recordings came straight from that little black book. And the next recording session after that, Miles would always say to Wayne Shorter, "Bring the book." So he always had that little black book with him. So a lot of the great things about Wayne Shorter to think about when you think about this record and his presence in this music. He was an overall great saxophonist and composer, like I mentioned, born in Newark, New Jersey in 1933. He took clarinet lessons at age 16 and then soon started playing saxophone before enrolling at NYU in 1952. He got a degree in music education, played in the U.S. Army for a couple of years, also played with the great Maynard Ferguson after he was discharged from the military. And then he joined Art Blakey's Jazz Messengers in 1959, where he was an important member for about 4 years. And he was Art's musical director, and he composed a lot for the group. And that's when, right after that, he joined Miles Davis's second great quintet in 1964, where he was a prominent contributor of compositions and great saxophone solos. Herbie Hancock is known to say that Wayne was the master writer of the group. At the same time he was with Miles, he recorded a number of albums for Blue Note Records as a leader and also as a sideman. And then Shorter formed the fusion group Weather Report in 1970 with co-leader, pianist, and composer Joseph Zawinul, and they lasted until about 1985. Wayne also played with the likes of Carlos Santana, Don Henley, Wallace Roney, Terry Lynn Carrington, until his next big endeavor with his own quartet, which he formed in the year 2000. And that featured Brian Blade, John Patitucci, and Danilo Perez. And in 2018, he retired from playing, but still composed and was relatively active until his death on March 2nd, 2023 of this year. So yeah, March 2nd was when he passed. And there's a couple of interesting personal life things to note about Wayne Shorter. Number one, he was married a few times. His second wife, Anna Maria, unfortunately passed away in a plane crash in 1986, the TWA Flight 800, where it exploded in midair and went down in the water. This was the second deadliest aircraft accident in the U.S. at the time. So a little interesting connection there with Wayne. And then also there is also a Tina Turner connection. And Tina Turner just passed away not too long ago this year. And apparently, according to Tina's memoir titled Happiness Becomes You, right after Tina left Ike Turner to escape the physical and emotional abuse she was getting, she moved in with Wayne Shorter, Wayne and Anna Shorter, for about 6 months. And she used their home as sort of a safe haven to get away from Ike. And also, I know Herbie Hancock was very helpful towards Tina as well. She would say that, you know, she really took advantage of her, quote, jazz friends at that time of her life.
Yeah, those are some really interesting connections there, because when you think of Wayne Shorter, you don't necessarily think of Tina Turner, you know, as being someone who he'd be personally connected with, but they were close. Some of the other players on this album, I mean, we just have an all-star cast here. We get Freddie Hubbard on trumpet, really one of the hard bop greats. I mean, throughout multiple eras of the music, from, you know, bop to hard bop into some of the later fusion stuff, Freddie's there for all of it. So we get Freddie Hubbard on trumpet, the fantastic Herbie Hancock on piano. Is this the first time we've had Herbie on the podcast?
No, we talked about him a little bit on Chick Corea's album that we went over, the fusion group with Kenny Garrett, and Herbie was a guest on one of those tracks.
Okay. So yep.
But we at least mentioned him.
We haven't gotten him in his full form yet, so this is going to be a real treat. We get Herbie Hancock on piano, and then we get the incomparable Ron Carter on bass, one of the best to ever do it. And then likewise, we get Elvin Jones on drums, also one of, like, just, you couldn't, I mean, these guys are all top three musicians on their instrument of all time. It's hard to really debate any of that with this, everyone, you know, Wayne, it's hard to, saxophone players, but Freddie, Herbie, Ron, and Elvin, I mean, most people would have those guys somewhere in their top three musicians on their instruments. So this is just an awesome cast. So I'm really excited to get into this one.
Yeah, we're basically getting three of the members of Miles Davis's group at this time, plus Freddie on trumpet. So Freddie's replacing Miles in that collaboration. And then we get Elvin Jones on drums instead of people like Tony Williams. So it's a really great mix of players that three of them we know play really well together and are just fantastic musicians, especially at this time of jazz recording and, you know, creation. So it's really great to see so many heavy hitters playing together. You know, that's one lesson to learn from this album. And I know we're not in school, but sometimes, you know, as jazz players, we think about, okay, what are the three or four things this album really gives me as a growing and learning and developing musician? And one of them is how well you can play together, even if you're such a big name and big player. And, you know, it's all about the music. And we hear that quite a bit on this record as we continue to talk about it. We'll see that come up again and again.
I think that's a great point. That's something that I didn't even really think about, but it's like, it's not about ego on this album. It's all about the music, and it's all about Wayne's compositions here. I mean, so that's a great point. These players are all great, and you could see where Herbie could be like, you know, his ego could get in the way. He could be like, oh, I'm so great, you know, I want to be featured in this way, but it doesn't seem like that at all. Everyone's just right in the music, in the compositions, and plays so well within what Wayne's written, so.
Absolutely. It's all about the music here. And speaking of that, shall we get into it?
Let's do it.
All right. The first track that we get on this, you know, classic album is called Witch Hunt. It's a great tune, and it's known well amongst players because of its use of the fourth interval. If you don't know, the fourth interval is the sound that you get like at the beginning of the Here Comes the Bride song. Or theme of the song, that first two notes, that opening interval is a fourth.
Also, blues music is from one to four. So if you think of that you know, the fourth bar in a blues change, that's going to the fourth there as well. So
that's true. A lot of fourth movements in jazz, and this just takes advantage of that. But I also really like the introduction. We get a crisp horn line equipped with two bar phrases where the tail end of the phrases are caught with the rhythm section playing along. It's a very neat sort of opening technique. It's got fire. It's got energy. We're hitting off right off the bat. Overall, the song is a 24 bar form. And over time, you realize Wayne Shorter really likes these 24 bar form tunes. Think about his classic standard Footprints in 3/4 time, but the overall form is 24 bars. And he just continues to go back to that form over and over again in his compositions, this one included. And Footprints and Witch Hunt are kind of similar, not only in song form, but also some chordal movement. It's not exactly the same, but it's very similar. And I also really love the lingering notes that bring in the, excuse me, the start of the song form. I want us to listen to that lingering note together and see how it develops within this first 25 seconds of the song. Yeah, you want to catch the entrance and the pulse of the drums, especially during that lingering note. And then the driving, heavy, swinging, walking bass that Ron Carter gives us pulls everything together. It's a great compositional technique. It's not that challenging, but it feels so good. And it sort of creates that tension and release effect that we often get in great music. Any thoughts on that?
No, we're getting kind of the feel for the compositions right off the bat. And just kind of the melodies stick out so much to me here on this album. So we're getting it kind of just right off the bat with Witch Hunt.
Yeah, now like I said, the melody sort of defined by that movement and force, and then there's a hint of a lot of thematic development. There's a lot of little themes that come together to make up the melody. It's sort of built by these repetitive themes, similar to moments that I hear in Wayne Shorter soloing. Mm. And that's a little connection I'll make, you know, later on too, that some of what he does with his improvisation comes out in his compositions. And we get that here with Witch Hunt.
Yeah. That's a great point, Max.
Well, you know, I'm trying. Also, the little fills that Herbie Hancock plays on the keyboard or on the piano, excuse me, during the melody are gold. It's just enough. It's not too much. It's like the icing on the cake. He's doing just enough that helps everything musically going on. It doesn't get in the way of anything. He's not playing too much. He's just playing what's right.
At every point in time, at all times. That's Herbie. And especially here, it's so good.
Yeah, those fills from the rhythm section are right on point. Then we get Wayne Shorter's solo, and I like his use of space, and his rhythmic differentiation. So he's using a lot of different rhythms and sort of taking his time a little bit. I think his tone overall is a distinctive feature of Wayne Shorter. It's well depicted here. The solo is a fair representation of what Wayne is heavily delivering at this time in his career. I really love the last third of this solo, a little bit more than the first two thirds of it. And the line of demarcation for me that divides that is at the minute marker 308, where Wayne Shorter is playing around with a 5 or 6 note melody that he creates. And he repeats it with this sort of funky phrasing that builds energy into higher held out notes that build on top of one another and continue to drive the solo until the trumpet solo starts. And I want us to listen to that moment together. It's sort of the last 30 seconds of Wayne Shorter's solo. Great use of thematic development, makes for a nice build, ends his solo on the low note that you'll hear. And there's just great, you know, movement at the tail end of the solo.
Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, there shows it all. I love that repeating idea, and it builds the energy. And I think it just proves that in general, Wayne Shorter is a very sort of organic player, especially by this time in his career. And you can't always predict where he's going and where the solo is going to take us.
That's funny. I hadn't even seen your notes, and I had written these are the thoughts that I had after listening to Wayne's solo. I said there's lots of personality here in Wayne's playing. And he's really crafted his own sound by this point in his career. Like, we're really hearing him come into his own. And his playing is just, it's so organic, and he's so unique in the way he plays. There aren't many other saxophone players. At times, there's, like, some Coltrane influence there. But it's, like, it's so unique. When Wayne's playing, it's pretty easy to tell it's Wayne playing the saxophone. So, and like Max said, so organic. It feels like it's just, nothing's forced. It's just all Wayne all the time.
That's right. And it's a little quirky, some of the things Wayne does. And there's going to be a lot more of that in a couple of the tracks that I'll hammer on. But it's definitely, I don't want to say an acquired taste, because it's not. It's legitimate. It's in there. It's real. It's defining a lot of the music of the mid-60s from jazz greats. Wayne Shorter had such an influence that, you know, his importance is undeniable. It's just his tone on the tenor saxophone is very specific. And at times, you know, when I first listened to him, I would think, I don't really dig this. I'm not, you know, that's not the sound I want, yada, yada. But when you actually listen to him and check him out, you know, you start to really value what he gives us when he's soloing. And that tone is just an extrapolated part of Wayne Shorter. It's an important thing. You know, your sound is your sound. And there's a reason to Wayne Shorter's sound that I didn't quite get the first time I ever listened to him.
Yeah, for sure. And there's definitely, at one point, I know that I have some questions about his tone. So I think we're going to get it a little bit more into his sound as we go throughout the episode here.
That's right. So more to come on that. Then we get the great trumpet solo here from Freddie Hubbard right after Wayne. It starts out quite nice with the use of little spaces. There's a certain undeniable sense of freedom I get when I listen to this Freddie Hubbard solo. He goes in and out of different ideas that are like short statements. And then he will move right into another juxtaposition idea, you know, just an all around different idea. And he often creates little themes. And then we'll play a longer held out note immediately right after. It's great soloistic development and movement. It's another sense of where is he going to go. He gives a lot in this solo in particular, including eighth note and double time lines, repetition, blues ideas, a great range, and awesome little spurts of energy. A lot of great things in this Freddie solo. And then we get the Herbie Hancock piano solo, and he definitely takes his time. He plays some great stuff with tons of intervallic movement and nice left-hand accompaniment. Some of what he plays reminds me of just a tiny bit of McCoy Tyner. I want us to listen to a snippet of this piano solo and listen for those things, especially that intervallic movement, where we tend to get some notes out of the key center. You know, it's rhythmically like spot on.
It's so good. That's so swinging. And we'll get, like, as we'll see, like, this is just incredible from Herbie. But as we'll see throughout this album, there's not much that Herbie can't do behind a piano. Like, he's got every single trick in the bag. So, yeah, it's just a taste here.
One thing I'd like is to hear Herbie do some stride piano, but I don't.
I know he could.
You know, I haven't heard that, but yeah. Other than that, you're right. And then we also get the melody back in after that great key solo. Herbie delivers so much, you know, we're going to go back to the melody. What else can you say? And again, this melody is catchy. It's also easily quotable when you're improvising. You know, if you just think about two or three fourth intervals, one after the next, going up and down, you can do that in a lot of different keys and use, you know, you can quote this head in your solo pretty easily, especially over a dominant seventh chord. So that's another great thing about this solo, as I've quoted it quite a few times. Ba-do-ba-da, you know, that's very iconic, and it's catchy. What were you going to say?
The only thing I have to add to all of those thoughts, I think that's a lot of really, you know, good sentiments about this song. The one thing that stands out to me that might not stand out if you're just listening through, because there's a lot going on with the composition, the melody, and the solos, is just the rhythm section throughout this tune. They are just so spot on. The dynamics, the sensitivity while comping, and just their swing feel. It's really, really spot on from Elvin and Ron and Herbie at all times.
I think you're absolutely right. And the only thing, the only example that's even better, well, there's two on this record, but one of them is the very next song, Fee-Fi-Fo-Fum, which also, I think, showcases the great rhythm section that we get here. Dwayne, you want to tell us about Fee-Fi-Fo-Fum?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, this is definitely an interesting tune, an interesting form on this tune. It's just an A-B-A form, and really cool composition here. The A sections incorporate like chromatic movement as well as using some 2-5 movement, and then the B sections kind of give us that 1-4 movement that Max was talking about before, and gives us more of a blues feel in the B section. So it's interesting how the A sections and the B sections kind of have their own feel to them, and they're a little bit juxtaposed in the way that they move. One moves chromatically and one moves more at an interval. So definitely interesting melody here, and the intro is somewhat haunting, which is, I think, is kind of the theme of this album, Speak No Evil. And there's definitely some dissonance in the last chord from Herbie before we resolve into the melody. And then this is just a really nice melody once again. It's great dynamics, and it's so well played by the horns. And one thing that really sticks out to me about this melody is the way that Herbie comps behind the A sections and the B sections. And it just highlights those differences in those changes. So he's using much more rhythmic chordal comping behind the A sections, and then many more blues stops and fills in the B section. So he's really highlighting kind of the differences in those sections, and he does a great job with that. So let's take a listen. I want to listen to just the melody, the composition by Wayne, the horns and how they're playing, and then take a listen for Herbie comping in the back and how he treats the different sections. So let's listen to the melody here from Fee-Fi-Fo-Fum. B section. Yeah.
Swing in. That bridge.
That bridge is so cool.
Herbie is also killing it with those fills.
Dude, he's so good. He's so, like, I think I've said this word once already. It's just sensitive. Like, he's so sensitive to what's going on, right? And it feels like he's just always doing the right thing. It's hard to even imagine someone who could play through that melody better than what Herbie's doing there.
His touch is also sensitive, like you said. Yeah. You know, it's dynamic, and it's not heavy. It seems natural. You know, everything that Herbie's adding to the melody or what he's doing in conjunction with the horn line and with the drums and bass. And also Ron Carter is swinging his butt off just doing, you know, just leading into those quarter notes a little heavier when that bridge hits.
Yep.
That, you know, two or three bars between the end of the A section and the beginning of the B section is just incredible how they're moving into that and transitioning. It seems so effortless, and it's riding the wave of the groove.
Yeah, and I think Ron Carter is probably the unsung hero on this album. We'll try to give him the praise where it's due, but he's just swinging so hard at so many points, but it's not necessarily always featured on the album. But yeah, really good to point that out. The difference from Ron Carter as well when we get into that B section. And then we get a Blakey-esque press roll into the trumpet solo. We kind of heard it there at the end of that, and that's just always hip whenever you do that. So I'm liking that there. And then Elvin is pretty busy at the beginning of Freddie's solo. And I like it because Freddie kind of comes in with a statement. And so Elvin's kind of like, all right, you know, we're going somewhere. Let's go. I'm going to come in, you know, hot and heavy with you. And then they kind of settle more into that hard-hitting Elvin swing that we know so well. Yeah, I love Freddie's first phrase of his solo, the way he comes in hot, and just the space and the blues chops as they settle into that B section from Freddie. It's incredible. Freddie's an incredible blues player, so some really nice chops there from Freddie Hubbard. And then once again, just really awesome comping from the rhythm section, but especially from Elvin. It's really, really nice. Just, I mean, Max said we're not in school, but we can all learn something, and that's just to listen. Just listen, rhythm section players. Listen to what's going on, and that's something that these guys do almost incredibly well. It seems like they don't even have to listen. They just kind of know each other so well that it's all coming so naturally.
Must I say it again? 90% of playing is listening.
Yeah.
Did you write that down? Write it down.
If they haven't written it down yet, we got to get it written. Put it on your bulletin board.
That's right.
So, but yeah, only one time through the form for Freddie. So not a super, super long solo here, but he gives us a lot in that one time through. And then Wayne comes in hot as well. And the one thing that stands out to me early in his solo is his articulation and how Wayne's not quite as precise with his articulation as some like more heavy bop players or more bop heavy players. Think of like Bird or think of Dexter, especially earlier in Dexter's career. A little bit later on, he kind of gets a little bit more of the Coltrane in his sound. So I'm not thinking necessarily that Dexter, but a lot of the bop Dexter stuff. But Wayne's sound to me is a bit more open and flexible. And this is Max, I wanted to ask you, what do you think about Wayne's sound here and just in general?
That is a complicated question because I have conflicting thoughts. I one basic thing, which I was going to wait until later to bring up, but it's the perfect time now. If you know, might as well bring it up now. Is there's a sort of a bird-like quality to Wayne Shorter's sound. He kind of sounds duckish or squawkish to me at times. And I don't know if it's because he's putting more mouthpiece in his mouth than usual, or it's some sort of reed mouthpiece combination, or it's just his natural embouchure, you know, that's the sound he gets. I don't really know particulars about how he's getting quite this. I mean, I know maybe it's some overblowing and some, you know, looseness with the jaw and bottom lip. And again, maybe more mouthpiece than I would have in my mouth. Stuff like that, I think, contributes to it. But all in all, it is Wayne Shorter, and it's very particular. It's like just a little bird-like, and I don't mean Charlie Parker. I mean literal birds come to my mind. I think of a big, like, I don't know, like a duck. I think of like a big duck walking around, and Wayne Shorter is right behind him. And then the duck, like, turns into a hawk, and then the hawk will turn into a hummingbird, and then the hummingbird turns into a cardinal. I'm getting that from Wayne Shorter, and those little things are those little different birds that I get from him. And I know that's like, what the hell are you talking about? But to me, that's what I get from Wayne Shorter. I get like this kind of flexible, happy bird. That's, I think he was a bird in his past life. I don't know.
He might have been. That might have been where that kind of open, kind of squawky sound comes from it at points.
Right, but it is organic and it's unique. And if you listen to his first kind of album as a leader introducing Wayne Shorter, he's a little more straight ahead in that album and more, you know, classic bop. But his sound is still kind of there, or at least you hear the beginnings of it and what we think of Wayne Shorter now with albums like Speak No Evil and how he sounded with Miles Davis. Some of that came out even in his earlier, more straight ahead work. His sound did. So I don't know. I'm not in love with his sound. I will admit that. But it's also quite unique and flexible, like you said. And he utilizes it in a lot of different ways that are musically appropriate and professional. And that's a great thing I dig about Wayne Shorter.
Yeah. And whether or not it's your favorite kind of thing, you know, whether or not you prefer this or you're more, you know, the straight ahead bop sound, it's a super well-crafted sound. You can tell that Wayne is...
Yeah.
There's a lot of work going into it, and it's very thoughtful the way that he plays, and it's very original. It's very Wayne. So, yeah, there's definitely a lot to be said for that. But, yeah, I was just interested to kind of get your thoughts on kind of Wayne's sound. So, but one thing I will say about Wayne and this solo is his phrasing in this solo is just so awesome. It feels like Wayne is telling me a story through this solo with his phrasing. So I really like that. And there's some really nice repetitive moments in there as well. And then a melody quote at the end of the solo, always a nice touch. So really nice solo here from Wayne. And we just a really good feel for his sound in this solo. And then Herbie takes the next solo, and we get some really, really nice blues chops here from Herbie. And then he ends with some modal movement, which is kind of the Herbie thing to do. And we're kind of getting that with this album, kind of combining the more classic hard bop blues stuff with some more modal, more almost beginning to sound more modern ideas in there. So, and then the head out is what you'd expect here, just back through the form. And this is just such a cool tune. It's so well arranged, composed. The melody is super, super interesting, and all these melodies just get stuck in my head so easily.
They're very catchy. Wayne is one of the best jazz composers post bop, undeniably. You know, I think that's very true. The other thing to catch is the endings of these tunes. They're not very complicated, but I want people to check out the cymbal playing from Elvin Jones. It just brings everything up to another level. And so listen for his use of the cymbals on the last note of this tune, Fee Fi Fo Fum, and other tracks as well on the album. Elvin Jones is delivering a lot, and sometimes you don't even realize it until you actually, you know, purposefully listen to it.
Yeah, for sure. So just, yeah, when you're listening to this, just keep in mind to listen for what the rhythm section's doing. Maybe take another listen back through and be like, all right, I'm rhythm section this time. I'm going to focus on Elvin and Ron and Herbie.
Exactly, yeah. Zone in on some of these players. And then we get a third track called Dance Cadaverous. Did I say that right?
Yeah.
All right. I think all in all, this Dance Cadaverous tune is very interesting. It's sort of an ominous melody. It also alludes to the title of the album, Speak No Evil. We're kind of inching closer towards that sort of vibe or feel, emotional impact that we get from things like Good versus Evil. Here we get that ominous melody equipped with long, drawn-out notes that reveal themselves as the recording continues past the introduction. It almost lingers, but listen to the dynamics that are used. And I think Wayne and Freddie are playing together so well on those dynamic movements of the melody, where they'll grow a long note in a musically effective way, and their releases are together too. The introduction is interesting because it mainly uses shorter notes, which juxtapose the long notes of the actual head or melody. Neat trick. And then it's also in 3/4 time, so we're getting a song in three here. It's made up of two 32-bar sections, multiples of 16. Wayne in his 16-bar melodies and phrases, we see it again. You know, he likes the 24-bar, and then here he's using the 32-bar section form of the song. We're getting also some minor-major sounds here. Think jazz melodic minor scale or more modal playing. And we also get a piano solo and a saxophone solo specifically. So not everybody gets a solo here. Herbie starts off his solo with some sort of shorter tension-filled phrases. And some of what he's playing sounds as if he's sort of floating on top of everything else. I want us to listen to that touch from Herbie Hancock on the piano and see if you can get a sense of that floating technique that he's doing. And I don't know if it's intentional. It just sounds like that's what he's doing. He's on the clouds while the rhythm section is just holding it down with the gravity of what they do.
Yeah, and I'm going to let this clip play a little bit longer than Max had maybe intended. I want to point something out about this. It's just Herbie's playing his... We get such a feel for his playing here and how far ahead of his time he was really on this track. And his sense of harmony and his ability to kind of paint color into his playing. Herbie can be such a colorful playing. And when we think about that, when we say the word color, we're kind of thinking about how can I use extensions to make this chord sound different in different ways. And Herbie is just really a master of harmony. And we're getting that here in this clip that we're about to listen to. So I want you to think about that kind of floating, and Max said floating thing. And I think that's just because Herbie is just such a master of harmony that he's able to kind of float with the harmonies that he's playing and what he's playing here. So let's take a listen to that, that snippet right here. Yeah.
Right. I also get the floating sensation from the length of his notes. And, you know, it's not exactly, I don't know, mechanically divided. It's, I don't know how to say it, but his rhythm is just like, it's a little loose, but it's in the pocket and it feels good and it's in there, but it's just sort of like
flowing.
I don't know. It's flowing. It's yep. It's windy. It's like going right into the next, but not in a necessarily well-defined way, but it comes across as defined just because they're great players and they're in there and, you know, Herbie's feeling it right. It's just sort of like, it's just like a cape floating in the wind, yeah. Or the flying magic carpet ride, you know?
Yeah.
That's what I'm getting.
Yeah. It's definitely really nice there from Herbie.
Now, I also want to check out a little bit later in the Herbie solo, because we get something quite different where he's more heavy-handed and he goes into some triplets and 16th note runs and ideas, and then he'll ease up a bit and go back into the floating style. So to me, this is sort of like a sandwich where the bread is where he's sort of light and floaty, and the meat and the bacon and the lettuce and tomato is this next part that we're going to listen to. And Dwayne, I want to hear what you think about it, but let's listen to it first, see what we think.
Yeah.
Overall, it's quite short. I mean, we're talking maybe 20 seconds, but that to me, that little clip is so different than the rest of the Herbie solo. I mean, there's a lot of ways you could think about it. I kind of think it's a little out of place. And I hate to say that about a Herbie Hancock solo, because how dare I?
I'm gonna argue that point a little bit.
I knew you would.
I think it's perfectly in place. I think that it kind of Herbie doesn't want you to just settle into this nice flowing playing, like it. That's not how Herbie is. He's not just like you can expect what Herbie's gonna do next. So I think Herbie's kind of, you know, throwing us a little bit through it for a curveball here, and it's, I don't know. I enjoy what he's playing. It's not what you might expect here, but I think it's in the pocket. It's interesting. It's unique. So I enjoy what Herbie's playing here.
It definitely matches the feel of the song and what the album overall intends for, I think. Parts of it sound more like an exercise in, like, I don't know, classic, you know, piano, classical piano is what I'm getting a little bit. I mean, not the whole thing. And you're right. It still feels good enough. It's still in the pocket, and he's taking you somewhere else, which is what great musicians do. So I do like that. It's different than what he was doing before he played that. It just kind of struck.
It is a little jarring. It's like, yeah, slightly jarring.
It's jarring. It's like, okay.
But I think that's the intention from Herbie.
Oh, I'm sure it is. And that's the great thing about these players is what they're doing. I mean, they mean it. And it's, again, musically interesting. And you're right. It is more or less appropriate. It just sort of came out of left field for me. But I like how he went back into the floating thing. I mean, it's not like you want to do the whole solo a certain way. Yeah. So I understand changing it up and going somewhere else with it. Just a little jarring, like you said.
Yeah.
And then we get Wayne's solo on this track. And I love his sort of rips and honks and he'll do lip falls. And this is sort of the flexibility we were talking about with his tone and with his sound and his approach, really, is where he'll do all sorts of little different things on the instrument in different ranges, and it comes across really well. And I want us to listen to just a little snippet of a solo and listen for those things.
The dynamics there were really nice as well. He like goes down in that kind of honk, but then he's really, really soft and gentle when he comes back in.
Yeah, even though it's post-bop jazz and what we'd consider maybe more modern playing, we still get character in Wayne Shorter's sound and approach. And that is what is so refreshing and interesting about Wayne Shorter is all the little things he'll do, like the honk and the little rip and lip falls that you think of maybe more swing era players or early bebop players. But Wayne Shorter kind of keeps that tradition and just plays around with it and does different things with it. And that's a great thing about Wayne Shorter. There's also a lot of up and down motion in a solo. And sometimes he'll juxtapose that while holding out a higher note longer than expected towards the end of a solo. And again, some of his sound is a little duckish, like I was getting at earlier, but it's just sometimes a little thin, but it's overall full at the same time. It's hard to describe it, again, like he's got more mouthpiece in his mouth than I would, but it also sounds like some beginning saxophone students I've had to deal with.
Oh God.
But you know, it's like refined. It's sort of that beginning squawky saxophone sound, but it's been worked on and it's been developed and molded in a way that is musically interesting and distinctive. And that proves, you know, the greatness of Wayne Shorter and what he can do with that sound is a lot more than a lot of other people could do.
Yeah, for sure. Yep.
Then we get that haunting melody that comes back in. And I think both the horns along with Elvin's purposeful drumming creates an added dramatic effect that makes this sort of long note melody or head come alive. The ending is very straight to the point, but it's classy. It's classic as well. So great endings that are, you know, they're not too involved, but they're also not nonsensical either. So all in all, a great track, Dance Cadaverous.
Yeah, very unique track as well.
Yeah.
And it fits the album super well. So yeah, it's a cool track. And now we get into the title track, the fourth track on the album, Speak No Evil. This one has an AABA form this time. The A sections are 14 bars, though, and the B sections are 8 bars. So interesting length to this form. And we get a lot of half step movements throughout the changes. We kind of spoke about how this is very much feels like a hard bop meets more modal jazz kind of feel. So that half step movement kind of alludes to more modal stuff going on. And we get a long tone melody through the A sections. And Herbie gives us some fills on the piano. And then we get a rhythmic B section that really builds throughout into the last two bars of the bridge. And then Wayne starts his solo out in the second bar of the form. And I love that. I think it just shows you don't have to come in super hot playing double time lines. Like, you can give the song, the form, some room to breathe before you come in. And so that's something that I like from Wayne here, and a good technique to keep in mind. And there's a really great use of different motifs. I think Max kind of spoke about this, like kind of the themes. Just a really nice use of different motifs and ideas in the A sections. And then he usually gets into playing more so lines during the B sections. And then we get the lick. And I think I in my notes I said maybe for the first time on the podcast, but we might have had it once before. Let's take a listen for the lick there on this track. Give me 1 second. Max, do you know another time when we might have had the lick or not? I don't know. You might.
I do. I think it was in T.S. Monk's album.
Okay.
What was that called? It had Helen Sung.
The name of the album?
Two
Continents, One Groove is the name of
the album. That's
it. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a cool
Two Continents, One. Yeah, it is. Two Continents, One Groove. I'm pretty sure the tenor sax player.
Yes,
played,
you're right.
Played the lick.
Yeah. So maybe, one of the first few times. But I'm sure we'll hear it a lot more. If you don't know what the lick is, go to YouTube and type in the lick. And then I think there's a YouTube video of, like, it just being played in a million different settings. Like, just different live clips of different musicians playing it. So, and you hear it in more than just jazz music. So let's take a listen for that. He doesn't play it verbatim, but he does quote the lick here during his solo.
Gotta catch the lick when you can.
Yeah, it's almost like a jazz meme at this point. Like, when someone plays the lick on a gig, it always, everyone looks over and gives them a little smile or a little smirk,
Right. The other thing about that clip is that beginning where he's repeating that one note, that. To me, again with the birds, I get an image. I get the woodpecker. I'm getting the woodpecker right there.
I want to see Max transcribe a Wayne Shorter solo, but not in notes. I wanted him to transcribe it in birds, or transcribe the notes and then above it put beginning and ending markers, like parentheses and the different birds. So you'll be able to see his transcription along with the birds that Wayne Shorter is for that point in time.
We're getting the woodpecker on that clip.
Okay, so we're at woodpecker there. That's good to know. Thanks, Max.
You're welcome.
But yeah, it's just cool. You can kind of hear kind of that, the kind of motifs that we talked about. Kind of he's like hitting on that one, Max said, repeating the idea and then kind of going into that lick there. And then Freddie kind of gives us a more linear fashion throughout his solo, which only lasts for one chorus. Again, we're only giving Freddie one chorus. I guess they're just like, Freddie, you're going to get a chorus and you're going to have to deal with it. So it has some really great moments. He comes in super hot on his solo right away. Kind of a different approach from Wayne, as I had mentioned, kind of giving it a bar to breathe. And there's much less space in Freddie's playing here as opposed to Wayne's playing. There's a lot of space in Wayne's playing. So definitely we're getting kind of different feels on the solos, which is, it's cool. Go ahead.
Yeah. I also think on this particular Wayne Shorter solo, it's a little bit more stellar in my opinion. I think he digs in a little bit more. There's like an extra shot of chutzpah in this sax solo compared with the others on the album. Not to say that the others aren't as good, because there are great solos, but here he just digs in a little bit more, and I'm really enjoying what I'm getting from Wayne Shorter during his solo on the tune Speak No Evil.
Yeah, for sure. And then as we kind of talk about solos that stand out, Herbie takes the, wow, I had written Harby instead of Herbie. I guess I don't know how to type. I was like, who is Harby? Herbie takes the final solo on the album, and it's just really, it's a masterclass here from Herbie. The bop lines are clean and they're crisp. His left hand is just on point at all times. The development of ideas from Herbie is fantastic. And he gets very rhythmic during the last A section, which is cool. And one thing we're going to do here, this is buckle in, because I want to take a listen to this entire Herbie solo, because I think it paints such a good picture as to why Herbie is one of the best to ever do it. It gives us kind of a taste of everything I've talked about with Herbie thus far in this album. I think we get it all here in one solo. So buckle in, we're gonna listen to Herbie's solo and really appreciate what Herbie's doing on this track. So let's take a listen to Herbie's solo on Speak No Evil.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah, behind the mute there.
Uh-huh. Well, that speaks for itself, doesn't it?
I don't think we need to say much.
One thing I want to say is it seems like every 4 or 8 bars, he starts centering what he's playing around a different idea.
Yeah, but it doesn't feel segmented, though. That's what's so beautiful about Herbie, you know?
Right, right. No, I had to really think about that point.
Yeah.
Because it comes across so organic and awesome, and you know, one idea right into the next, and it's so spot on rhythmically, it feels good, and he's giving us so much in terms of language and ideas, and playing around with both rhythm and melody and harmony. It's great, and I zoned in on that. It's like every 4 bars he starts centering what he's doing around a sort of movement, and then he extrapolates it from there.
Yep. And that development, that's one thing that I kind of mentioned, is that development of the ideas is so fantastic. And one thing that stood out to me there, I didn't have it written down, but his feel is so good. He can play behind the beat so well. I don't know if we talked, I'm sure we've mentioned it, but playing behind the beat in jazz is, you'll hear Oscar do it so well, is when you're intentionally not playing on the beat. You're dragging behind the beat, but it's in order to kind of swing the feel a little bit more. And Herbie can play behind the beat so well. We heard it at points there. It's just like so deep in the pocket when he does some of that stuff.
Yeah, you can drag a little bit and then catch up on the feel too, you know, and that's where we get that swing, that pulse, and it's sort of the consistency of how well you're going from behind and back to the beat, or maybe some players are a little up front of the beat, you know, they'll kind of push the beat a little bit, and that sort of swing and movement is what makes great jazz great, and we're getting that here from Herbie and the Gang. We also get it from Ron Carter's bass on this track. His bass line during the A sections is unique and very, you know, well-defined, but it moves really well. It feels really good too. And I think both Ron and Herbie's accompaniment here is masterful. We get a sense of sort of a peaceful movement. I don't know, on specifically Ron Carter's bass line, where it's sort of like during those A sections, some of what he's doing sounds like he's sort of falling, you know, ba da ba da ba. He's going down the bass.
Yeah.
I'm getting falling leaves or like this peaceful yet very long waterfall. Don't look down. The water's nice, but you could fall to your death. I mean, that's that's what I'm getting. But you're not going to fall because of how well Ron Carter is swinging.
He's holding it together. Yeah. And I appreciate Max continuing to point out what Ron does so well, because it's like so good that it's almost easy to miss at points, if that makes sense. Sometimes bass players are so good, you don't even realize how good it is until you're specifically listening for them.
Yeah, that's right. It's like you don't realize how good it is because of how good it is.
Yeah. Yeah. If it were bad, it'd be like, "Oh man, well that didn't fit well." But with Ron, it's just like everything is so right where it needs to be and so tasteful and well placed. So
anything else on that?
No, that's it. Just really some awesome solos on that. And Herbie, I mean, whew, we get a sense for why Herbie is who he is and why he's become the player he's become.
Yeah. Speak No Evil speaks for itself.
Yeah.
And then we get the fifth track, the penultimate track called Infant Eyes. This is a classic ballad that we know of associated with Wayne Shorter. And this is sort of the ballad on the album and the recording of this tune. Don't be like me and confuse this title with the other ballad of a similar name called Angel Eyes. Angel Eyes and Infant Eyes are two very different songs. And
thank you, man.
I think there was one. Well, I'm pretty sure I was on a gig once and either the bass player or somebody asked me, "Hey, you know Infant Eyes?" And in my head, I was like, "Yeah, I know Infant Eyes. I like that tune. It's a great, great tune. I love the Gene Ammons version." And in my head, I was like, "Wait, that's not Infant Eyes. That's Angel Eyes." So,
there is before, no Gene Ammons version of Infant Eyes. I don't think.
I was gonna say, those are not the same. So I immediately clarified, said, "No, let's do Angel Eyes." He said, "Oh, okay. I can read that one." So we were on two very different wavelengths. So don't be like me. And this is another great Wayne Shorter composition. It's an ABA form with 9 measure sections. He's not doing those 16 bar sections or 24 bar sections here.
It's so unique. His compositions are just, yeah, it's different. It's not like, let's just play, 16 AABA or 20 bar. You know, it's so unique from Wayne.
Let's do 9 measure sections. Yes. How does that sound?
Yeah.
And all in all, original ballads are hard to write and are even harder to pull off if you're not thinking, you know, Broadway or the classic Great American Songbook tunes, or maybe like the Duke Ellington ballads we get, or people like his great composer friend Billy Strayhorn. Those guys could write ballads, but the average saxophone player that's great at jazz improvisation and plays all the gigs, it's a little harder for us to write ballads and even have ballads become jazz standards. So props to Wayne Shorter for just not only attempting it, but for having his tune become so iconic. It's kind of hard to do have an original ballad do that. And I think this is probably the most listened to track on Spotify because of that. It's so iconic. The melody we get is equipped with many long notes. It's kind of whole notes or dotted half notes, and it's usually accompanied with 3 eighth notes leading into those longer notes. And I get a sense of moodiness from this melody. It's making me feel a lot of different things at once, and harmonically we get a number of sus chords. There's a nice mix of minor chords, sus chords, and major seventh chords. So sonically we're getting a lot of different things in addition to a great lingering note melody. We're also getting pretty sensitive playing in general on this one. They're definitely in no rush on this track, and they're also definitely not slowing down. The energy is subtle, yet present and not forced, and that's another lesson here. If you're a player, you know, you can play in a way that's sensitive and subtle, but you don't slow down, and that's the key difference between, you know, the men and the boys, as they used to say. Wayne Shorter is the feature here. We get a little bit featured piano playing from Herbie Hancock flashing through at times. Overall, there's great length and directional playing. It's as if we're showcasing terrific soloistic movement, but sort of in slow motion. And I want us to hear that a little bit together, get that sort of sense of how slow we are, but it's still moving at the same time. Any thoughts?
I don't know. I almost forgot to pause it because I was just like kind of entranced. It just right. moves so well together. They're all so playing so well together. And yeah, that's really nice.
I really like listening to Wayne Shorter's long notes when he's improvising. Mm-hmm. You know, not only do a lot of songs on this album utilize longer notes in effective ways, but he also does it in a solo, and that's not typical of most saxophone players and many at this time. I mean, different players play differently, but he really does that, and you can hear that on that last note of that snippet there, almost the last note.
Yeah,
so it's great what Wayne's doing. Herbie Hancock also solos just one 9-bar section. He's very colorful, great sonic approach. It's fun to listen to Ron Carter on bass during this tune as well. He basically emphasizes a lot of root movement, either on beats 1 and 3, or he'll do some eighth note repetitions on the chordal roots too. I want us to listen to a little bit of that and zone in on what Ron Carter is doing. It works to leave space and be supportive, but again, not be in the way. It's a lesson for bassists out there. You don't have to play so much all the time as long as you're locked in.
Yeah.
He's just going, da-dum.
Yeah, he's just pedaling.
Yeah, it's pedals. And it's sometimes on 1 and 3, it's sometimes as eighth notes. So he's playing around with the rhythm more than the notes, I think. And it's just such a great technique and supportive way of playing as a bass player. More great Ron Carter.
Yeah, for sure. I mean,
then the melody. Yeah, go ahead.
More great. It's all great. It's like so good.
Hey, remember how Ron Carter was so good the last tune? Well, he's even better this tune.
It's like, wow, he's still fantastic.
Then the melody comes back in. I love Wayne's use of vibrato also on this track. He kind of goes back and forth from straight tone to using vibrato on some longer notes. And we're going to listen to a little bit of that. Pay attention to the stylistic choices he plays on with these drawn out notes at the end of the tune. Especially that last note reminds me of one saxophone player in particular, but let's listen to it first, and I'll mention that at the end of this. Yeah, so a couple of things to say is I really like Wayne Shorter's tone on this song.
Yeah.
And that's a different feeling that I get from some of his other solos on other songs. And so, for some reason, when he does a ballad, it's sort of opens up his sound a little bit, and he'll pull more tricks out of the bag in subtle ways, like how he's treating these longer notes at the ends of them. There is some vibrato. There is a lot of style. You just got to pay attention to it. And at the very end of that, he has a little bit of subtone with that classic vibrato, and we're getting a little inch of the great Ben Webster at the end of that. That's what, you know, that last 10 seconds, I was like, okay, there's some Ben Webster here. There's some classic ballad playing that is in Wayne Shorter, and it comes out at moments like this.
Yeah, especially that last note, the way he holds it out and then kind of tapers into the vibrato and releases there. It's very, it feels very Ben Webster for sure.
Exactly, and that's not a connection you'd normally make. I can't remember who it was. Maybe Stan Getz. I don't know the particular player, but there was a great saxophone player. I'm pretty sure maybe Stan Getz, and somebody asked them, who is their favorite ballad playing saxophonist? You know, who's their favorite sax player to listen to play ballads? And this guy said Wayne Shorter, which is kind of out of left field. Ballads, you usually think Ben Webster, you think maybe Gene Ammons, you think Illinois Jacquet, I Quebec, that type of player.
Dexter Gordon.
Dexter Gordon, even John Coltrane.
Yep. Oh, yeah.
You know, but you don't normally think Wayne. And so I wouldn't bet on it. Maybe it was Stan Getz. I'm not sure. But somebody, you know, big and famous, noted Wayne Shorter as their favorite ballad player. And that was really surprising.
Yeah.
Yeah. But you kind of get why when you listen to Moments of Infinize.
Yeah, for sure. Well, let's move on to the sixth and final track on the album entitled Windflower. This tune is in 6/4, which is cool because how many songs in this era were in 6? I don't think it was that many. And just another time where I enjoy the composition of the melody here. It's just a really nice melody, as all the other tunes are basically. And the rhythm section comping on solos in this is just top notch. It's top notch throughout the album, but it's continuing here. So Herbie is just, he's so creative, and Ron and Elvin are just so tight and so expressive in the way that they comp. It's so on point from the rhythm section here. And then we get some really cool lines from Herbie in his solo, kind of showing off some of his chops with the double time lines here from Herbie. And there's a really cool ending to his solo. I want to take a listen to the ending of Herbie's solo here on Wildflower.
More Herbie, huh?
Yeah, gosh, imagine that. I'm like, oh, let's listen to what Herbie's doing here.
A piano player listening to a piano player.
Yeah, it's crazy. All right, here we go. Yeah, I just like that rhythmic kind of development there.
That 10 seconds was, sorry, my dog's barking at nothing.
She's barking at Herbie.
Right. She said, great solo, Herbie.
Yeah, she's fine.
That little 10 seconds there put the biggest smile on my face. It was just sort of a very happy moment. I don't know why, but, you know, the rhythmic interplay he's doing, it just sort of lightens up the seriousness of some of this music, and those kinds of repetitions make me smile. I don't know.
Yeah. It's just so, like I said, creative from Herbie. He's just so creative, right? It's like he doesn't fall into just doing one thing over and over. I mean, there are some pianists that are really good at like certain things. Not to box McCoy Tyner into, like, McCoy's incredible, but McCoy has definitely a way of playing that he falls back on a lot, you know. But
that's
Herbie
true.
Is just like, you never know what to expect from Herbie. He could play that kind of McCoy Tyner modal kind of thing, but he can also give us so many different things. So he's just so creative at all times from Herbie. So I really enjoy that. And then one thing that we get throughout the album, but here again, is just really nice dynamics from the horns in the melody. The melodies here are just all so dynamic, and their playing in general is just all so dynamic. And Freddie and Wayne just really do mesh really well together, and we get that here on the melody. And overall, I think this is a nice tune. It's not the album's best, but I think there's definitely some cool stuff going on here.
Also, Herbie also delivers a lot of double time lines, and so his chops come out just a little bit more this last track. So that's a neat thing too. And you don't expect to have more than one song with a different time signature. And here we get two songs because of this one and Dance Cadaverous, one in 3 and one in 6/4. So that's a neat thing about this album too, is that two of the songs are in a different time signature other than 4/4.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. And so, yeah, it definitely fits the album well. It's interesting as a closer, but I definitely enjoy this track. But let's get into, now that we've wrapped up all of the tracks on the album, let's get into our top three tracks and our not so hot track for this album, Max. Why don't you go ahead and go first there?
Why, thank you, good sir.
Yeah.
My top three tracks, number one, we got the title track, Speak No Evil. The name of the album, the name of the song, the name of the tune that reminds you what a great rhythm section should sound like. So we get that on Speak No Evil, and all the little things that Herbie adds and the way Ron Carter swings and the solos. I really like what Wayne Shorter does. He sort of digs in a little bit more, and just a little bit more energy we get from him, which is matched by Elvin Jones's playing. Everything just comes together and synchronizes in a way that's undeniably great. And we get that with Speak No Evil. Number two, Fee-Fi-Fo-Fum. I think the bridge is swinging. You know, it's swinging me in my seat. That's how hard we're swinging on that bridge. So some great things on Fee-Fi-Fo-Fum. Number three, my third track, my third favorite is Witch Hunt, the first track on the album. That melody is stuck in my head, and great solos as well. I think Infinite Eyes is an honorable mention. It's so iconic and important that you got to mention it and talk about it. I just prefer some of what we're getting from a couple of the other tracks just a little bit more. And then, if you don't know, for every album, we both provide a not-so-hot track. Sometimes it's very clear and evident what that is. Other times it's very difficult to pick a track that's not up to par with the others. This one was somewhere in the middle. I went with Wildflower, the last track on the album, as my not so hot for a number of reasons. Number one, it's just, if you took that track away from the rest of the album and you still had the first five tracks, the album would still be so great.
Yep.
So that's what I had to go with. Even though I like Herbie's solo on it, and it's great to have a 6/4 tune and there's a lot in there, it just wasn't quite up to par with how well other things went in the other tracks.
Yeah. I think that you make some great points there. And so my number one track on my top three is also Speak No Evil. I just think we get so much from all the players on this track. It's the title track. It's the melody is incredible. The playing's incredible. The solos, Herbie's solo, as we listen to the entire thing, awesome. And then my second track is Fee-Fi-Fo-Fum as well. Just another really cool tune. This is one of the tune that kind of, like, the melody sticks in my head a lot from this tune. And I just love the composition. I love kind of the change between the different sections and the feel. And then, my third track is Witch Hunt as well. And I hate when Max is so right, but what can you do? I do think that Infant Eyes belongs somewhere in the top three, maybe for some people. But these are kind of personal top threes, and I think Infant Eyes is, if you could put it number one, and I wouldn't argue with it, or anywhere in the top three. So that's a great tune as well, and good honorable mention, Max. So I hate when Max is right. It really has bothered me for, I mean, how long have we been friends? No, I'm just kidding.
Right.
But Max hit the nail on the head here with his top three. And also the not so hot. I think Max makes a great point. Wildflower is an awesome tune, but I don't think you could take any of those other five tunes out of the album. I think it would be way more devastating than if you were to pluck Wildflower from the end of it. So, I didn't mean to make that pluck a wildflower. Okay.
Hey, no pun intended.
So I agree there. The not so hot for me is Wildflower, but still a nice tune and some really cool stuff going on. But let's get into our overall album thoughts and our ratings here. So I'll go ahead and go first with mine, and I'll let Max go second. So Speak No Evil is regarded by many as Wayne Shorter's finest work, and the proof is in the pudding on this album. All of the elements fall right into place on this quintessential Blue Note recording. The compositional determination and the elite group of musicians all basically in the prime of their careers. This album has withstood the test of time and is still so well regarded by current musicians and critics. The compositions have so much character, and they're just incredibly dynamic, as is the playing on them. There cannot be enough said about the players on this album. Wayne and Freddie are a match made somewhere beyond heaven. Freddie compliments Wayne so well and stands out when called upon. And there just really aren't enough words to describe Wayne's playing on this album. It feels like a true coming of age, I'm here to stay, this is me kind of performance from Wayne. And Wayne just does Wayne so well, and it's beyond a pleasure to soak in him kind of, you know, express himself on this album. And so the rhythm section on this album will be living in my dreams for the next few weeks, and it's deservedly so. It's just it's perfection in rhythm section form. I mean, it's hard to give that high of praise, but it really is. Ron Carter and Elvin Jones could be twins for all I know, with the inherent level of telepathy and togetherness. It's incredible how glued those guys are together. And I can't even get started with Herbie Hancock's performance here. I mean, we kind of realized it as we were listening. I'd be like, let's listen to Herbie here and here and here. His playing on this album stands out in so many ways to me. He shows he has every single trick in the bag and he can do it all. And Herbie was certainly ahead of his time, and lots of what he's playing here is putting this on full display. He brings what would now be considered a more modern approach to a 1964 Blue Note recording, and I think that's enough said for Herbie there. This album deserves all the praise it receives, and there's a warm seat for it in any Jazz Hall of Fame. It simply does not get a whole lot better than this album here from Wayne Shorter and Company. And my overall score is a 9.5 out of 10, so definitely a really good score for this one.
So you like Herbie Hancock, is that what you're selling?
Yeah.
Is that what you're saying?
It's weird because, like, I think he's great, but, like, he's not, I don't always love everything that Herbie does, but this is so spot on from Herbie. I mean, Herbie's incredible, but this is great Herbie right here.
Would you say this is some of the best Herbie on record?
Yeah.
Probably?
I think so. I mean, there's so much great Herbie, but this is just, I mean, it gives you everything you need. I mean,
it's like, go ahead.
No.
Okay. I was just going to say, it's almost like that word perfection that we'll associate with guys like Hank Mobley or somebody.
Yeah.
But here it's like a different side of perfection. It's like, it's everything is meant to be where it is. And that's hard to be that consistent.
Could anyone else have done a better job on this record? I mean, could there be a better piano performance on this record? I don't know if it's possible.
Well, yeah. I mean,
there's some greats who would do a great job, but, like, Herbie just is so, everything about Herbie's playing on this is so fantastic.
Everyone is so well matched.
Yep.
It's hard to deny that there would be a better player for this particular album.
Yeah.
So I think you're right about that. My overall thoughts, here we go. I wrote a lot, so dig in. Basically, I think this Blue Note Classic is a collection of originals by saxophonist Wayne Shorter, who's accompanied with an all-star cast. It's basically Miles' second quintet without Miles, and we're swapping out Tony Williams for Elvin Jones here. We're graced with Herbie on piano, legendary bassist Ron Carter, the fantastic drummer Elvin Jones, in addition to getting great trumpet playing from Freddie Hubbard on most of these tunes. The compositions, I think, speak for themselves, as well as the solos. Witch Hunt starts the record off, equipped with an interestingly energetic introduction that leads us into a melody defined by its use of the fourth interval. There is a sense of attitude behind this head, which helps aid the passion expressed in the tune's improvisations. Wayne starts off nice and strong before he heads into some longer notes, followed by great short runs that go into a playful, repetitive theme, working to continue drive, energy, and interest. You can also clearly get a sense of Wayne's distinctive sound and approach right off the bat. I think his sound is a unique, almost duckish quality to it. It's obviously distinctive at first, and it also seems like an acquired taste, but trust me, it grows on you really quickly. The first track also includes my favorite trumpet solo on the record from Freddie. A sense of true freedom is felt in the iteration of Freddie's lines and ideas. Herbie swings really well on this one too. The only thing more swinging than that would be the next track, Fee-Fi-Fo-Fum. The bridge is directly related to the blues, while the feel has a deeper pocket and swing than we'd normally expect from Mr. Shorter. It's got a great medium tempo too, which is being taken advantage of by everyone here, especially trumpeter Freddie Hubbard. Ron Carter's bass makes the track come alive. Listen for how well he is locked in with Elvin in the depth of the quarter note. Dance Cadaverous is a similar tempo, but in a three feel. Wayne's melody uses lingering notes in very interesting ways. This use of longer notes is a defining element to this album and will be utilized in other tunes on this album too. Wayne also plays a lot with sound, using all parts of his range at varying dynamics. He's definitely organic too. Herbie's solo is interesting as well. He almost floats atop everything else while playing this almost classical feel around the 240 mark. Perhaps a little out of place, but maybe not. It seems like a moment of third stream. The next track, Speak No Evil, is a masterpiece. If you listen to the fills of Herbie, the bass lines of Ron, the togetherness of the horns, and the in-the-pocket cymbals of Elvin Jones, then you understand why. We also get more digging in from Wayne on his solo and a top-notch piano solo from Herbie Hancock. Infant Eyes is likely the most referenced tune from this album. It is hauntingly brilliant, complete with Wayne's moving yet slightly quirky tone and light but powerful accompaniment from the rhythm section. Wayne's use of vibrato is great too. This track is the ultimate example of what one can do with expressive long notes. Wildflower is the last tune on the album, giving us a second song with a different time signature. The dynamic synchronicity between Wayne and Freddie is on point. Herbie's double time improvisations are also a nice touch. It's also important to listen to the varying ways Elvin Jones accompanies the solos. He's building along with each soloist and listening while engaging in endless swinging activity. His presence raises the level of musical engagement, making sure the album concludes in a satisfactory manner. Wayne Shorter's Speak No Evil is a stellar recording that exemplifies the quirkiness and creative artistry that one imagines when that name, Wayne Shorter, is mentioned. Along with catchy melodies and a hauntingly brilliant ballad, we get terrific solos and important collaborative contributions that end up making a huge impact. The rhythm section accompaniment on the title track is the prime selection of that occurrence, in addition to Elvin's drumming on Wildflower. In general, this album is deserving of serious engagement with your ears. Even though Wayne Shorter passed away earlier this year, his music continues to live on. Speak No Evil is a must-listen when one takes into account the organic solos, positive swing, engaging accompaniment, and the presence of a legendary lineup. Overall score, 9.3 out of 10.
Yeah, awesome. There's a lot of really good points there, especially when you said serious engagement with your ears. I usually listen to music with my ears, Max.
Some people listen with their eyes.
Oh,
and they don't get it.
That's
you know
no
what
good.
I mean?
That's no good. I guess they must have infant eyes then if they don't get it. Oh, I'm just kidding. All right, so our overall combined Jazz Jam score for this album is a 9.4 out of 10. Definitely one of the higher ranking albums that we've listened to on the podcast. If you want to see our power rankings and all of the ratings that we've done for albums and kind of want to listen to some other episodes, our website is a fantastic place to go to kind of get an idea of what albums we've reviewed, where they fall in our power rankings list. So go check out our website. It's linked in the description below in the show notes. So yeah, it's just a really awesome place. You can kind of get bios for all the musicians. You can see our overall thoughts if you just want to read through. You can see our power rankings. Definitely a cool spot to go check out. Max, why don't you tell us a little bit about our next episode's album? And I think we're going to be trying to get on more of a 2-episode-a-month schedule from now on. So that's kind of what we're looking for. We'll do one modern and one classic album every month.
That's right. Yeah, we'll do one classic and one newer, more modern album. Not necessarily musically more modern.
Yeah, although, newer. Yeah.
Although a lot of times the two will coalesce. Yes, yes. And correlate. And I do want to say, we have been getting some emails from listeners, and we appreciate the engagement too. Mm-hmm. Feel free to email us with maybe a listener question or an album recommendation, or just to tell us you enjoy us, or maybe give us ideas about how we could do things maybe a little bit better. You know, feel free to send an email at thejazzjampodcast@gmail.com. But you're right. Our next episode, we will talk about Artemis and their new recording, In Real Time. Artemis is a newer group made up of exclusively women jazz musicians. And it includes players like Renee Rosnes, who's well known, and others like Alexa Tarantino. There's some great musicians that collaborate together in that group called Artemis. And they've been getting around a lot lately. And so their new record, In Real Time, on Blue Note Records, is what we'll go over in our next episode. And they've been getting some high praise, so we'll see what we think.
Yeah, that's one thing. Max had suggested a couple of albums, and I was like, I've been seeing this Artemis album everywhere. I was like, I think we kind of, let's take a look at this one, because it seems to be a hot button album. So I'm excited to listen to it. I've briefly checked out some of it, but I'm excited to really dive into the album and some of the playing on it. So definitely something to look forward to next week, or not next week, whenever this album comes out.
well, hopefully, I guess in 2 weeks.
In a couple weeks. Goal. Yeah.
Yeah. And it's their second album. So I think they've been a group maybe 3 or 4 years.
Okay.
So this is their second release, and it's been making a splash.
Yeah, so super excited. Just thanks for everyone for listening to this episode. Definitely a really awesome album and a really cool way to kind of remember Wayne Shorter and his legacy. I mean, he played for so long, played up until basically, you know, the end of his life. So a lot of great things from Wayne and so many players that were influenced by him. So it's great to check out kind of his staple performance, the one that people think of. So it's been a really cool episode.
Yeah, it's great to dig into some of these players and what they do. And again, there's always things to learn from these musicians and to listen for, and the way they interact with each other. You know, it's one of those moments where it's like, I kind of wish I was in the recording studio at the time they were recording this album.
Yeah.
You know, all the things you could get, the way they interact. I mean, how does Wayne Shorter compose so many great songs and then they pull it off so well in the studio? I mean, what was that process like? I mean, we know about the little black book where he wrote ideas and then he probably wrote charts out and yada, yada. But, you know, it's like there's a certain level of camaraderie and musicianship that is on this record that you don't get all the time.
Yeah, it would be super, super awesome to be just a fly on the wall, like to know, like, all right, how many takes are we doing, you know, or any of these first takes, or is like, how many takes are we doing, or how much rehearsing goes into some of these compositions, or is it pretty easily picked up on by, you know? So it would be just super interesting to be a fly on the wall and to see kind of Wayne, you know, crafting the album the way that he wanted. Does he, you know, tell people specifically, like, hey, I only want you to do one chorus here, or I want this way, or to kind of see how it all comes together? This is one where it'd be super, super interesting to be a fly on the wall.
I get the sense he was kind of more open about it. Yeah. I mean, he probably said, okay, here we'll have trumpet, here we won't.
Yeah.
You know, do this, a little bit more, do this a little bit less. But I feel like he was the kind of leader that let the players add things in a way that he knew would be musically advantageous and would sound good, you know, and let them be a little bit.
And with these guys, I mean, you don't really need to tell these guys much. I mean, it's like,
exactly. Yeah.
It's, these guys aren't like rookie musicians. These guys are some of the best to do it. So yeah, that's a great point by Max. It would be super interesting, but yeah, it's been an awesome episode. Really, really a great listen. If you haven't listened to this album, listen to it from front to back. It's definitely worthy. I don't think I'd ever done that. I've listened to all of the tracks at some point, but never in that fashion. So yeah, really cool to get into this one, and just want to thank everyone again, and definitely go check out the website, and we'll see you in next week's album, which is In Real Time by Artemis. So for Max Levy, I'm Dwayne Gunnels, and this has been an episode of the Jazz Jam Podcast.